So let us start this webinar. This webinar is conducted by an IAPTCB, that is a Twin Cities branch of Hyderabad. Okay, so this lecture is very particular lecture, and this is dedicated to our legend, Dr. Sudarshan Reddy sir. And this lecture is on clinical examination of newborn. And he was a profound pediatrician and a great man. So, and often I would listen to him how he would clinically discuss cases. So I think it's a great opportunity for everybody to remember him with this lecture, and it is a dedication to Dr. Sudarshan Reddy sir again. So we are going to talk about examination of the newborns, and we look at the vitals, gestational assessment, anthropometry, screening for malformations, and Sriram will move on from there to see the systemic examination. So first, when we saw talk about vitals, we talk about temperature, heart rate, pulses, respiration and respiratory rate. Then we look at SpO2 and look at the blood pressure. So we'll go one by one, each one of them. Now temperature is usually measured in the axilla using digital thermometer. To measure the temperature, keep the temperature parallel to the body, and tip should always be in the axilla. Unlike children, there is no need to add extra degree Celsius to the temperature, because brown fat is available in the axilla, which itself adds the 1 degree, which is there in the newborn. So in newborns, no need to add that extra degree Celsius. And always note the core to peripheral temperature difference. You should also measure the sole temperature and the central temperature in the axilla, because this will tell you if the baby is having only... So, Sriram, can you see the slides? Sriram, can you see the slides?
Not done. Yes, sir. We can see the slide.
Okay, I'm audible.
Yes, sir. Audible.
Okay. So keep the temperature by measuring the axilla, and always periphery should be warm in newborns. So this is how many of you can tell me whether this is the correct method of measuring the temperature? You can write in the chat box whether it is right or wrong. Okay, very good. Many people have said it is wrong method, because there are two things in this. One is the tip is not in the axilla, and the second, it is better to be in the parallel. So when you're parallel, you can tip is always in the axilla, or look at this figure, how it should be. So your tip should go into the axilla. Otherwise, there is no point in measuring the axilla temperature. So ensure that the tip is in the axilla, and also ensure that the temperature probe should be almost parallel to the axilla. So these are the normal temperatures in newborn. All of you know that 36.5 to 37.5. Less than 36.5 core temperature is called hypothermia. Less than 34 is called moderate to severe hypothermia. Hyperthermia is when their temperature is more than 37.5 degrees Celsius with warm peripheries. Fever means pathological. It is usually when the temperature is more than 38 degrees or 100.4 degrees Celsius, and with cold peripheries. Whenever pathology is there, mostly peripheries will be cold. So always, as I said, it is not just the temperature, look at the core to peripheral temperature difference. And because if the peripheral to cold temperature difference is more than 2 degrees Celsius, and some people said that it is more than 2.5, is almost very sensitive of infection. So it's an early marker of sepsis. Fever with cold periphery, definitely it is sepsis. Fever with warm peripheries, most likely it is environmental fever. Now coming to the second vital, that is heart rate. Always count the heart rate and multiply by 6 to get the, count for 6 seconds and multiply by 10 for getting the heart rate in 1 minute. This is what we do in the neonatal period during the resuscitation. But if you have time, it is better to record for 1 minute. Normal range is 100 to 180. This could be variable based on the state and gestation. In preterm babies, the heart rate could go sometimes up to more than 180, and the bradycardia less than 100 can sometimes be seen in children during sleep. So bradycardia could be normal during sleep, less than 100, but normal is 100 to 180. So when do you get tachycardia? Mostly heart rate more than 180 is considered to be tachycardia. If you have fever, seizures, pain, or shock, you could get tachycardia, hypovolemia, you could get tachycardia. Bradycardia is mostly sinus, less than 100, but sometimes bradycardia, sinus bradycardia can be seen in hypothermia. But pathological hypobradycardia is usually because of conduction defects or because of congenital heart blocks. Hypothyroidism can present as bradycardia in infants. So always when you look for pulses, always palpate for all the pulses for volume. Low volume pulses are seen in shock and hypovolemia. It is important to remember the bounding pulses, because in newborns, if bounding pulses are there, most likely we're dealing with anemia, PDA, or AV shunts, arteriovenous shunts. One very important thing is to look at the right upper limb and the femoral pulses. Although you may not appreciate the radiofemoral delay, what you see in children, but if upper limb pulses are good, but femoral pulses are weak, you might hit on a case of coarctation of aorta. So always palpate and palpate the femoral as well as the right upper limb pulses, because the difference between these two can help you to pick up a coarctation, especially after 24 hours after birth. Before discharging the baby, always palpate the pulses. So assess for regularity. Normal, it is regular, but irregular rhythms are mostly associated with bradyarrhythmias, and irregular pulses is mostly because of arrhythmias like atrial flutter, heart blocks, or ventricular ectopics. Although ventricular ectopy could be seen in many children, it is mostly a normal phenomenon, but you should rule out hypoxia and electrolyte imbalances in these children. A radiofemoral delay, as I said, is difficult to assess, but difference in pulse volume could be there in right upper limb and femoral. So, but when pulse is more than, heart rate is more than 1220 per minute, mostly it is pathological. We might be dealing with a case of paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia. Less than 60, mostly it is a case of heart block. And whenever you pick up a case of heart block, you should evaluate for maternal SLE. 50% of children with heart blocks could have underlying SLE in the mother, and mother may not be knowing that she has a problem. So differential pulses, as I said, is could be an indication for coarctation. Bounding pulses, already we discussed, it could be with PDA, anemia, and malformation. In a newborn, in the first few days, if bounding pulses are there, if PDA is ruled out, very likely it is a case of vein of Galen malformation. If you auscultate, you might be able to heard a bruit on the skull. So two important malformations which can cause bounding pulses. One is vein of Galen, other is hepatic AV malformations. Now, once we look at heart rate and pulses, most of us look at their respiration and respiratory rate. Apnea and gasping is an emergency. Gasping is same as apnea. If the baby is gasping, it should be considered as apnea, or the baby will require intubation and subsequent management. Unlike children, babies or newborns have periodic breathing. Breathing alternates between fast and slow. And this is mostly occurs after feeding or after crying. The babies have fast breathing, which is normal. So that is why we say that if you're counting the breath rate of a baby, you should count after maybe half an hour after feed, and if the baby is crying, you should wait for some time before counting the breath rate of the baby. Breathing is mostly abdominal in babies, because you have to look at the diaphragmatic movement to see whether the baby is having good respiration or not. And always look for grunting and nasal flaring, which are signs of alveolar collapse or lung disease. Stridor could be inspiratory, expiratory, or a continuous stridor, which is a disease of upper airway. And look for recessions. Sternal and suprasternal recessions are signs of upper airway obstruction. Intercostal and subcostal retractions are signs of lung diseases, lung-related diseases. So respiratory rate, count the respiratory rate for full 1 minute. So many times people will ask you, how do we count for 1 minute? Put your hand on the abdomen, and if the abdominal movements are there, that means each movement is counted as one respiratory rate. Normal range is 30 to 60 breaths per minute. Respiratory rates varies with gestation, state, and feeding. We have said that in premature, it could be higher. Post-feeding or in babies who are active, the breathing could be faster. Now, when you have only tachypnea, most likely you are dealing with a cardiac case or a respiratory case. Tachypnea could be there with cardiac case, respiratory case, and also with acidic breathing. And sometimes CNS breathing also can be tachypneic, like hyperventilation could be a feature of CNS breathing too. Bradyapnea, that is central nervous system depression. Whenever there is raised ICP, you could have bradyapnea. Rarely, it could be a sign of neuromuscular disorder. And hypothermia, hypothyroidism can cause bradyapnea, like hypothermia could occur. Hypothyroidism could be associated with slow breathing. Now, if you have brief period of tachypnea and apneas, so a dysmorphic child who has intermittent tachypneas and suddenly stops breathing, so this is a sign of Joubert syndrome, which appears like a molar sooth appearance on the MRI. So if you have a very peculiar type of breathing abnormality in a newborn, you should think of Joubert syndrome. Coming to the blood pressure, always blood pressure in the newborn is measured with oscillometry using NIBFP monitor or a multi-channel monitor. In any sick child, always at admission, measure the blood pressures. Always it should be measured when the baby is calm, in the right upper limb and also in the right lower limb, at least one pressure should be done. And look for systolic and diastolic and mean blood pressure. One very important thing which we always look for in newborns is the mean blood pressure. So because most of the diagnosis is made from the mean blood pressure. In very sick children, invasive blood pressure is preferred over non-invasive blood pressure. For knowing the normal range, because normal range depends on gestation and postnatal age, we often use a charts called Zubrow's charts. BP recording should be done using a correct size cuff. It is said that the width of the cuff should be at least 50% of the arm circumference. The width of the cuff should be 50% of the arm circumference. And it should be measured on the right upper limb for the first time. And it should be done twice, at least 15 minutes after the cuff placement. Record three times in supine and prone position to get an average, and that is the correct BP for that newborn, for measuring any hypertension or hypotension. And measure 1.5 hours after feeding or after medical intervention to get the appropriate or the right blood pressure in the baby. So this is how you tie the cuff to the baby. Remember that there is an arrow on the BP cuff. This arrow should continue corresponding to the brachial artery. This is the correct way of tying the cuff to get the correct blood pressure. So these are the Zubrow's charts, modified Zubrow's charts. And you can see that they have the postnatal age on the x-axis and you have a systolic and diastolic pressure, which is displayed. So you have, this is for day one, but there are a lot of charts to be seen for after first day of life. As a rule of thumb, any man mean blood pressure less than the gestational age. For a baby 32 weeker, if the MAP is less than 32, very likely the baby has a low blood pressure. For hypertension, you add plus 20 to the gestational age, that could be the 99th center or 95th centile for that baby. So gestational age for a 32 weeker, that is 32 plus 20, that is MAP more than 52, could be a case of hypertension for that baby. So these are simple rules, but you have to look for the charts for ultimately for knowing the correct hypertension. Now coming to the next vital, that is saturation. Saturation is measured by pulse oximeter and measure saturation in the right upper limb and lower limb, because any difference between right upper limb and lower limb more than 3% is considered to a case of pulmonary hypertension. Avoid movement artifacts. Although Masimos can detect movement artifacts, but it is better to avoid. Remember this, the normal range of saturation when a baby is on respiratory support, even if it is oxygen, is 90 to 95%. But if the baby is not on oxygen, more than 95% saturation is normal. So if your baby is on oxygen, up to 90 to 95% is normal, should not be above 95, should not be below 90. But if the baby is on room air without oxygen support, then the saturation should be above 95%. And as I said, the difference between upper limb and lower limb should be less than 3%. Now we all know the pulse ox screening we have to do before discharge of a newborn baby. And this should be done to identify critical congenital heart disease. So all babies should be screened more than 24 hours after birth before discharge to pick up for congenital heart disease, critical heart diseases. So it should be done if the baby is after 24 hours or shortly before discharge, if before 24 hours, less than 90% in the right upper limb or right foot. So what we have to do, immediately the baby is considered fail, he goes for echocardiogram. But if it's between 90 to 95% baby is breathing room air, or the difference between right upper limb and right lower limb is more than 3%, you repeat the screen. After repeating, if it's less than 90, goes for echo. But if again 90 to 95% or more than 3%, repeat again once. All the three times, if it is between 90 to 95% or more than 3% difference is there, is it considered to a failed screen and you have to get an echocardiograph. But if it is less than 90%, anytime it goes for echo. In the three screens, if it is more than 95% and if the difference is less than 3% between right upper limb and right lower limb, then this is a pass screen, no need of a further evaluation. But nowadays it is felt that apart from pulse oximeter, you have to do a clinical examination, that is look for color of the baby and also look for femoral pulses. The next vital is the capillary refill time. This should be done, measure on the sternum, press it on the sternum for 5 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Release it and see for, it should be the refill should occur within 3 seconds. 1001, 1002, 1003. So within this time, the thing should finish up. The refill should occur. Then it is a normal CFT. Any CFT which makes more than 3 seconds is abnormal, could be a sign of hypovolemia. But very fast refill could occur with early sepsis and in children with hyperthermia or with shock or with tachycardia. Now, it is always good to remember these, but it is better to have a chart. So you should always have a chart in an NICU for the heart rate, for blood pressure, normalcy, abnormalcy, and also have a chart for complete hypertension diagnosis. Coming to the color. So we finished heart rate, pulse, respiratory rate, saturation, and BP. Then comes the color. Color, many consider this as a vital parameter. It indicates wellness of the baby. Normal is pink color both in the center and periphery. Isolated central cyanosis of the tongues and lips is indicator of congenital heart disease or methemoglobinemia. How do you differentiate cyanosis because of methemoglobinemia from inotic heart disease? Is by doing a blood gas. If your blood gas is normal, if the blood gas is normal, but baby has cyanosis, PaO2 is normal, but cyanosis is there, and saturation is low, that is methemoglobinemia. If saturation is low and PaO2 is low, it is hypoxia. If you see differential cyanosis, that is upper limb is pink and lower limb is cyanos, then it is a coarctation of aorta or interrupted aortic arch. Many of the other colors you might be seeing, like if the color is off color, it could be an early sign of sepsis. Pale is because of shock or anemia, sometimes due to asphyxia. It is called asphyxia pallidum, where the peripheries are pale. Fluctuating color in different parts of the body could be seen, like in autonomic instability could occur because of harlequin change. Suddenly you will see that if there is a posture change, one part of the baby's body is red or pink, the other part is pale. This is called harlequin change, could be a normal phenomenon, could occur mostly in preterm babies. But it could be the mottling or the fluctuating colors could be a sign of severe illness like shock or sepsis. Dusky peripheries could be a sign of early sign of sepsis or fever, or hypothermia, or cold stress. And we know that yellowishness could be because of jaundice. Now, what does this picture shows? What are the differentials you should consider when the baby has this sort of skin color? What is it and what are the differentials you should consider? People can type in the chat box. We can see that. So sepsis, hypothyroidism, hypothermia, very good. So these are the differential one concern. One, it could be a normal phenomenon. This is cutis marmorata or mottling. Yes, harlequin, it is not harlequin, but it is good to be a cutis marmorata. Yes, but it's a physiological phenomenon also in preterm babies. But it could be an early sign of hypothyroidism, temperature instability. Yes, many of you have said rightly, could be sepsis, hypothermia, or hypothyroidism. If you do not have signs of sepsis, hypothermia, please rule out hypothyroidism in this baby. Now look at this. What does this baby have? Very similar baby, but it gives you a diagnosis in this. What all this baby has? Please write the findings and then we will see the diagnosis. Yeah, he has abdominal distension. Look at the legs. Look at the legs. Look at the hands. Yeah, he has abdominal distension. He has mottling. Coarse face is very good. Coarse face has started developing. There is no differential. This is, yes, there is some umbilical hernia too. So this is what? Diagnosis is hypothyroidism. Very good. So if you see abdominal distension with mottling, with prolonged jaundice. So I think none of you have written jaundice. This baby also has prolonged jaundice. You can see the yellowish hue. So this is a case of hypothyroidism. What type of color discoloration is this? What kind of difference discoloration is this? Anybody? Please write in the very good cyanosis. Saturations are normal. Baby is on phototherapy, yes. Okay, very good. So everybody has told this is bronze pigmentation. Yes, this is bronze pigmentation. Bronze pigmentation occurs because of cholestatic jaundice or a sudden hemolysis causing inspissated bile syndrome, that is secondary conjugated jaundice, and then bronze pigmentation takes over. So this is bronze hue or bronze pigmentation. Very good. So next comes the color after color gestational assessment. Gestational assessment we normally do between 12 to 24 hours. This is because estrogens causes tone relaxation. That's why we do the gestation after 12 hours. Best time is done after 1 hour after feed, and best state is 3 to 4, state 3 or state 4, which Sriram is going to discuss. And the best method is new Ballard scoring system. And I'm sure all of you know the new Ballard scoring system. It has 2 points on which you do the scoring. One is the neurological maturity. The second is the physical maturity. In the neurological maturity, you have the posture, you have square window, you have arm recoil, your popliteal angle, scarf sign, and heel to ear. And in the maturity, physical maturity, you have skin, which is scored from 0 to 5, lanugo, plantar species, breast nodule, ear, cartilage, genitals in male or genitals in female. Together, you get a score, and based on the score, you get the gestational assessment. This is the best objective method of doing Ballard's gestation assessment. Ballard score is the best score because it can be done even in the sickest of baby, because you don't have to lift the baby, you don't do any maneuvers. In a sick baby, that is why it is considered the best scoring, and it can score from almost from 20 to 44 weeks. So that is why this is considered one of the gold standard methods of scoring, but this cannot override your LMP. If LMP is accurate, LMP is the best method. Follows the Ballard's. If the difference between LMP and Ballard's is more than 2 weeks, if LMP is normal or appropriate or ideal, you go with LMP. But if LMP is not correct, then you go with Ballard's. If more than 2 weeks, less than 2 weeks, definitely you have to go with the LMP only. So anthropometry. So those are the vitals and then the gestationalist. Then we look at the anthropometry. Weight should be measured at birth, at discharge, and in between as and when the baby requires it. But 2 weights should be done in newborn babies at birth and at discharge. And we know that there is a weight loss in the first 1 week, and that should be recorded. The prerequisite for doing the weight here, baby should be naked without diaper and clothing, ensure a warm room and clean, disinfected scale. Always, it is known that neonates lose their weight in the first 1 week. Term babies can lose up to 5 to 7% of the birth weight in the first few days and regain the birth weight by end of first week. But mostly by 10 days, if they do not regain their birth weight, it is abnormal. Preterm lose weight, more weight up to 15%, but they get little more longer time to regain the birth weight by 2 weeks. Length is measured using an infantometer in the newborns. I will show the infantometer, how it should be then. And the lower limb should be stretched and extended for looking at the length. Measure once a week in growing preterms. At least length should be measured once a week and put on the growth chart. I'll show you the growth chart. And measure once a month in the term babies. Occipital or frontal circumference should be measured using a non-stretchable tape encircling the occiput and the forehead, the prominent aspects. And it should be measured once a week in growing preterms and in term babies once a month. So you should always use a digital scale. You should first put the, you should clean it, put a paper, tear it to zero, and then weigh the baby. Now, length is done with an infantometer. This is an infantometer. You stretch the legs. Bring this to touch the soles. Sole should be perpendicular to the bar so that you get the correct length. and head circumference. Head circumference should touch the occiput, the forehead, and always overlap on the side to see the exact head circumference. So chest circumference should be measured around the chest at the level of the nipple. And normally head circumference exceeds the chest circumference by 3 cm in term babies, and it could be more than 3 cm in preterm babies. In infants of diabetic mother, the head is not affected. So body looks big, but the head looks small. Head is normal, but looks small compared to the body in diabetic babies because the brain does not require insulin for brain growth, whereas rest of the body requires insulin. So that is the hyperinsulinism will cause body growth, but head growth is normal. So what is this baby? Is it an LGA baby or IDM baby? Is it an LGA baby or IDM baby? LGA, IDM. Okay, now those who are saying IDM should give the reason why it is IDM and not just LGA. Why it is not LGA? It could, yeah, why it is IDM? So when the head appears smaller compared to the body, then it is called IDM. Both have large body, but IDM babies have head appears small. If you put on the centile, head centile will be normal, but body centiles will be more. So when there is a difference between the chest and head circumference is more than 3 cm, that is chest is more than 3 cm compared to the head, because we expect 3, but if it's more than 3, baby looks big. This is a case of IDM. What is this? What case is this? Anybody? So clinically, the baby has a large head. Okay. Macrocephaly, yeah, but only when you put on the centile, you can cause. How can we say it is rhizomelic shortening without any measurements? IUGR, okay. Okay, Chanchal has already told it is rhizomelic shortening, but the way to look at is extend the hands. If you extend the hands of a normal children, the hand should touch the mid-thigh. Hand should touch the mid-thigh. If the hands are short, then they will have come only till the abdomen. Head is large, but the trunk is large, but the limbs is short. This is rhizomelic shortening, classical of achondroplasia. So these are the expected things which happen in a preterm baby. Weight gains about 15 to 20 gram per kg per day till this preterm recovers come to term, that is till 38 to 40 weeks. Length gain is 0.75 to 1 centimeter per week till it becomes term, that is 38 to 40. A 28 weeker till it becomes 38 to 40 weeks, he will gain 1 centimeter per week in length, and OFC also 0.75 to 1 centimeter per week till he reaches term. After he reaches term, the growth rate is like term babies. So then you have to plot them on the, for term babies, you have to plot on the WHO chart to see whether they are malnourished, whether they are stunted. And for preterm babies, till they reach the term, we use the Fenton chart to say whether they are SGA, LGA or AGA. And we use the Ehrenkranz chart to see how they're growing with the nutrition in the NICU. So there are two types of charts, which are called reference chart and intrauterine growth charts. We use the reference intrauterine growth charts. These are the standard charts. They help us to define SGA, AGA and LGA. These are the Fenton charts. But reference chart is used for seeing how we are compared to other units. So these are like Ehrenkranz chart. If you give optimum nutrition, how the growth is going to be, because nobody can have a growth which is like in utero so far. So if you follow in utero, everybody is going to follow below the centiles. That is why we have to use a reference chart. So WHO charts can be used in term babies from birth to 5 years, and there are separate charts for boys and girls. Always plot on the charts to know whether they are malnourished, what is the level of malnutrition, and whether they are stunted, whether it is acute or chronic. So these are the Fenton charts. Fenton charts always have length, weight, and head circumference on the same chart. There is a separate chart for boys and girls. So this is for girls, the other one is for boys, and these are the Ehrenkranz charts. The difference between the postnatal growth chart, that is Ehrenkranz chart, versus the in utero chart is, in the Fenton charts, you can see the weight goes up, straight up. In the Fenton chart, the growth goes straight up. Whereas in the post-natal growth chart, that is the Ehrenkranz chart, which are reference chart, you will see there is always a dip and then is up. These lines are the 50th centile lines for each birth weights. Whereas in the other charts, you have gestation as the x-axis and the y-axis will be the weights. Here, the y-axis is weight, x-axis is the postnatal age, and the each of the curve represents the birth weight. So Pondrel index is third anthropometric parameter which we look for. It is helped to classify the IUGR and also to say whether symmetric or asymmetric IUGR, and also to know the severity of IUGR, we use the Pondrel index. So some clinical application of the charts. Now look at the dots here. So this baby is what? What are these dots? All is in the 50th centile. So this is AGA. Very good. What is this baby? What is this baby? Weight is less than the 10th centile. Other head circumference and length is normal. So this is SGA. Very good. What is this baby? All three, length, head circumference, and head circumference are low. So this becomes symmetrical IUGR or constitutionally small AGAs. So in fact, the second one can be called IUGR. The last one, the purple ones, can be called SGAs or constitutional or symmetrical IUGRs. The first was AGA, second was asymmetry, third was symmetrical IUGR. Okay, this is the postnatal growth charts. Now this is what used for reference. Now look at this baby. Now this is the growth chart of a baby where you are seeing that there is some increased weight gain in the baby on the third to almost 10th day. So why this baby has a sudden unexpected weight gain? Is it because of good nutrition? Is this weight because of good nutrition from third to seventh day in this preterm baby? Yes or no? No, very good. So it is because of edema or fluid retention. So what causes fluid retention in a baby on the second or third day and lasts for a week in a preterm baby? So renal, no, in a preterm baby. PDA, very good. So diagnosis is made. When you look at this chart, you know that this baby had PDA and that's why there was a weight gain. And once you started treating PDA, it has come back to normal and started putting on weight. Now look at this chart. What does this tell you? So there was PDA, treatment was given, there was PDA again, didn't respond. So ligation was done and improved, and later baby has started growing a centile. One episode there PDA, second it could be sepsis and or it could be PDA. Now he started gaining weight. Now you can see that he was gaining weight and there was a drop in weight. He should have followed this centile, but there is a drop. And this is after 28 days. So these babies should be evaluated for anemia, hypothermia, hyponatremia. So if you look at these charts, you will know what is the reason for baby to lose weight and not gaining weight. So they are very useful tools to identify the cause and also start treatment. So you can start TPN, you can do fortification, and you can also do skin-to-skin contact to improve the weight gain of this baby. So if you put the weight on a Fenton chart like this or IUGR chart, all the babies, so these are the three curves of the babies, all the babies by the time they become 36 weeks, they'll all become less than 10 centile. All will be considered as ex utero restriction. So better to use reference charts like Ehrenkranz to know the growth. But if you want to see whether the baby is born in utero or not, you have to use the in utero growth chart or Fenton charts. So coming to after growth, looking at the other things like pallor. Look at pallor in the hands and feet, pallor in the mucous membrane. Babies who are hypothermic or shock also have pallor. Common reasons for pallor are blood loss or hemolysis. Blood loss could occur because of fetomaternal. It remains unexplained. If there is no cause, you should think of fetomaternal. Blood loss could occur from umbilicus or early cord clamping, subgaleal bleeds, internal bleeds, and hemolytic anemias. If there is hemolysis and pallor, you will also see jaundice. Cyanosis, you should look for central and peripheral cyanosis, should look for mucous membrane cyanosis, and we know that cyanosis could occur because of respiratory or cardiac illness. So if it is respiratory, like respiratory cause of cyanosis, apart from cyanosis, you will see that babies are sick looking, they have tachypnea and retractions or grunting. So if you have tachypnea, retractions, grunting, and cyanosis, it is respiratory cause. Predominantly cyanosis, it is cardiac cause or acidotic breathing. So acral cyanosis is very common in the first 24-48 hours, but after 24-48 hours cyanosis persists, you should think of polycythemia. Do not administer oxygen only for acral cyanosis. Edema, look for edema in the dependent areas. Many times edema is only in the dependent areas. As unit are lying supine, you should also look for edemas in the lateral aspect of the trunk, lateral aspect of lower limbs and occipital area. And common reasons for edema are asphyxia, preterm, and severe edema could be there because of cardiac, renal, or hepatic failure. And non-pitting edema occurs in lymphedema. So let us look at this. Where does this baby has edema? This baby has edema in the all over the body, lower limb, upper limb, predominantly upper limb, predominantly lower limb. Okay, Hindu says it is hyponatremia, legs, yeah. Everybody says edema is in the lower limb. Okay, very good. So edema is predominantly in the lower limb. So there could be two reasons. One is a dependent edema, if the head end is elevated, or there is scrotal edema also. Very good. Very good. So what is the other finding you can see here? There is bladder distension. Severe bladder distension can cause edema. So this is the reason for edema in this baby. You catheterize the baby, the distension, bladder distension, edema can come back. What is this edema and what is the diagnosis? This is a different type of edema. I'm trying to show you the diagnosis here. What is edema you have here? And what is the diagnosis? Milroy. Okay, lymphedema. How do you know it is lymphedema? Yes, it is pitting, non-pitting edema. No, it is not arthritis. Lymphedema, yes, yes, yes. It is lymphedema of the lower limbs because it was non-pitting edema. It was predominantly on the dorsum of feet, not on the legs. So, yes, some people have already made the diagnosis. It's a Turner syndrome. I'm trying to show you the shield chest, wide space nipple, and the carrying angle, which is very wide in a newborn also. So jaundice is the last thing which you will see color difference. That is always the age of onset is very important. If you have staining of palms and soles, then it is a very severe jaundice. Depth of jaundice needs more experience. Always look in the daylight to say what is the level of jaundice. Red flags are early jaundice, jaundice in sick babies, and jaundice in preterm babies. And you know this typical chart. You can use this chart if you are doing in the daylight, but best used to do a serum bilirubin to know the jaundice. Prolonged jaundice is seen in jaundice more than 2 weeks in term babies, more than 3 weeks in preterm, and always correlate whether it is direct or indirect. Direct jaundice will have the dark staining of the urine and pale stools, and this is never conjugated jaundice is always pathological. But if it is prolonged unconjugated jaundice, always look for hypothyroidism, galactosemia, UTI, and extrahepatic biliary atresia. So I will end by doing the head to toe examination once again. So we finished the vitals. We looked at the anthropometry, gestational end, and pickle, pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing edema, and lymphadenopathy. Now looking at the head to toe, look for congenital malformations. Do a orifice counting. We said don't pass the tube, but do a counting. Look at the umbilicus, nose, mouth, ears, anus, urethra, and vagina. Look for the face for symmetry. And eyes, open the eyes and look for cataract and bivalves. And head to toe examination, look for the mouth. Look for cleft palate. May say many times cleft of the hard palate and soft palate could be missed. Count the fingers. Look for the palms for dermatoglyphics. Evaluate the umbilicus for arteries, two arteries and one vein. Look at the spine for cleft. Genitalia, look for scrotal swelling. Look for undescended. Position of urethra, labia. Sriram is going to tell you detail about abdominal examination. But one interesting finding. If the baby has shock on day one, and if there is staining of the scrotum. Scrotum looks hemorrhagic. That is, it is bluish color of the scrotum and you have hypotension on day one. What is the diagnosis? Scrotum is blue and baby is shock on day one, day two. Wonderful. Everybody knows the diagnosis. So this is a case of CAH, not CAH, adrenal hemorrhage. Adrenal hemorrhage, bilateral adrenal hemorrhage. If it's unilateral, it clots only on the side. That is because of lateral seepage. And also look for dysmorphism. Look for epicanthal folds, occiput. I would suggest all of you to download this app called Cradle app. So this is the app you should always have. This is a Cradle app. where you take the photograph of the baby, you can see whether it is a normal or a white reflex. In fact, you can look at the previous photographs also and see many of your babies had a white reflex and you have missed it. So please download this app, simple app. It is present both on Android and iOS, and pick up white leucorrhea in all babies before discharge. Some markers for malformation, drooling of saliva, think of TEF, absent DOA, spina bifida, heart disease, and DDH. Radial limb defect, think of TAR and anemia. Single umbilical artery could have because of CHD. Port wise stain could be Sturge-Weber syndrome, polydactyly renal malformation. So what is this? What is the association you have to think of? What association you have to think of in this baby? CHD, very good. One more. DDH, very good. One more. So CDH, DDH, and no, not hearing. One more. Vertebral. So this baby had heart disease. You can see the vertebral anomaly. Heart disease and vertebral anomaly. Yes. What does the baby have? What does this baby have? Diagnosis. Very good. What should you look at? What should you look at? Pierre Robbins. Immediately you should look at the cleft palate. Yes. So this baby had a large cleft. What is this baby has? What does this baby have? ARM, very good. What other malformation you have to rule out in this baby? Good, look for Vactrel. And look at this baby. This baby has a TEF. The same baby had both anorectal malformation and TEF. So if you have ARM, you should look for TEF. If you have TEF, you should look for ARM. And also look for the vertebral anomalies. What does this baby have? What does this baby have? Leucorrhea, very good. Cataract. What problem this baby could be looked for? What are the associations? Very good, very good. What else? Rubella, yes. Galactosemia, Lowy's, wonderful, wonderful. Hypercalcemia. Okay, retinoblastoma, very good. So, what did this baby, what is the diagnosis? Very good, everybody knows CH, very good. What is this, what is the diagnosis? Ambiguous genitalia, dysgenetic gonads, atypical genitalia, very good. What is the diagnosis? One side testis, other side no testis. Asymmetry is most likely because of over-testis. Very good. Most likely it is dysgenetic gonads. So it is not like male or pseudo, but this is dysgenetic. Very good. So I will leave the platform to Sriram to start the systemic examination. So please, Sriram, you take over. I will mute myself. Sriram, you are there? Sriram? Sriram, you are there? Yes, Sriram. Sriram, you start. Yeah, I can hear you. You want to share your screen?
Yes, sir.
I will make you the... So, I'm making you the presenter. Can you share your screen and see? Maybe you should be able to do it.
No, sir.
No? I'm making you the host. Now you can share it. Yes, Sriram, your screen is great now.
It is seen, sir, screen?
Yeah.
Yes. So, good evening to you all. Am I audible, sir?
You are audible, Sriram.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, good evening. So I'll take another 20 minutes to half an hour to finish off the systemic examination. So let us see one by one. So the first system, which system you start examining depends on what kind of symptoms the baby is presenting with. If the baby is presenting the respiratory distress, then obviously we will start with respiratory system examination. So if a baby is in encephalopathy or if he is convulsing, then you usually look at the central nervous system examination. So it depends on what kind of the system, the symptoms and the signs a baby is presenting with. So respiratory system, it starts from the nose. So don't think that it only starts with the lungs, because air enters from the nostrils, isn't it? So we start looking at the from the nose. One of the important cause of respiratory distress can be a simple nose block. Many a times I must have seen that babies who present with upper respiratory tract infections, they can have nose block, and that can mimic a significant nose block, can mimic a severe respiratory distress. So, but how do you identify it? Usually they have a very noisy breathing. They tend to have a very stertorous breathing, especially if there is a pooling of secretions in the upper airway, then that can lead to a stertorous breathing. So that could be always a cause of severe RD. So if you are hearing a noisy breathing, then you can just put some saline drops into the nostrils and then do a proper suction, gentle suction with a mucus sucker. And then then you can observe whether it is going to relieve the breathing or not. If a baby has significant nose block with significant distress and is cyanosed, but that gets relieved by on crying, then it suggests bilateral corneal atresia. So this always you should remember. It's a rare diagnosis. It doesn't happen day in, day out. But if you observe a baby who has severe nose block and is significantly tachypneic, but the moment he opens the mouth and then starts crying, he becomes pink. So that gives a clue that this baby is having it. And how do you confirm it? You can confirm by passing it. Nasogastric tube, you will find it difficult to pass the smallest, even the smallest size nasogastric tube will find it difficult to pass into the both the nostrils. And if you want, you can confirm by a CT scan of the nostrils, of the nose. It will show an obstruction in the posterior corner. Now, this has been already dealt with. So if you have from the nose, always look at the oral cavity, because the oral cavity also gives a lot of clues for the respiratory distress. There could be anomalies in them. There could be retrognathia. The tongue could be falling backward. As sir has already told you about the case of Pierre-Robin sequence, where you will find a retrognathia, a small tongue, and a retroflex tongue, along with cleft palate. So that gives a diagnosis of Pierre-Robin. So this upper airway obstruction, because of the either mandibular hyperplasia or the tongue which is falling backward, or because of cleft palate, all these things can cause significant respiratory distress. There could be simple pooling of secretions can lead to stertorous breathing. That is, baby can have very significant noisy breathing, and there is a very severe pooling of secretions with drooling of saliva. Then you can always think of tracheoesophageal fistula. The clue from the antenatal history would be a polyhydramnios. So a mother who is having a polyhydramnios and you, on examination you find a lot of pooling of secretions, then you always suspect a case of tracheoesophageal fistula, and you can confirm where again the difficulty in passing the NG tube into the stomach. Sometimes it may be difficult because NG tube gets coiled in the esophagus. The best thing would be to pass a very soft red rubber tube. This red rubber tube doesn't get coiled, so it gets stuck in midway in the esophagus. Because we can measure the length of the red rubber tube that has to pass into the stomach. Isn't it? Just like you put the nasogastric tube, you can always measure the length of the red rubber catheter which has to pass. But if there is an esophageal atresia, it gets stuck somewhere in the middle, and you know that it is a case of tracheoesophageal atresia with or without fistula. And X-ray always helps you in confirming the diagnosis. Now, the another respiratory problem which many of us see is the stridor. This stridor can be, usually stridor means there is a specific sound which happens when a baby is taking a breath. This can, usually it is inspiratory in origin, but it can be biphasic also. But the most common reasons are laryngomalacia, where the epiglottis is quite cartilage. Baby takes a breath, the inlet narrows and leading to a inspiratory sound. The other common cause are laryngeal edema, which usually occurs in post-extubation scenarios, or sometimes severe gastroesophageal reflux. And they both coexist. Laryngomalacia and GER, they can coexist. And many of the severe cases of laryngeal malacia usually have some amount of gastroesophageal reflux also. So both become synergistic, and the stridor becomes quite severe in these babies. And of course, viral infections are another reasons. The other reasons are vocal cord palsy, calcemia can present as a stridor, and rarely it can be a vascular ring or a sling. So whenever a baby has presence with stridor, you should always look for all these causes. Like you should look for laryngomalacia, if you do a direct laryngoscopy. The best one to will be to do a endoscopy examination where you don't, because in direct laryngoscopy, you may stretch the laryngeal inlet as you put the scope into the posterior part of the oropharynx. You may stretch it and it may give a pseudo appearance of laryngomalacia. But otherwise, the best way is to do a nasal endoscopy and then pass the endoscope into the oropharynx and then look for the laryngomalacia. That will be the best way to look at it. The other causes you should rule out are look at the calcium. And the other thing, if the baby has a history of respiratory infection, possible laryngomalacia. So you can use a laryngoscope to confirm the diagnosis. The other thing is to look at the vascular rings. These are rare things, but this also can cause, because an aberrant, either a double aortic arch or an aberrant left subclavian artery, which is arising along with the right aortic arch, they both, the trachea becomes entangled between these two major vessels. And this creates a narrowing, and this is the reason for the stridor. So this is confirmed by echo. Echo can give a clue, or sometimes may be difficult even with echo. And if you have a strong suspicion, the baby may need a CT angiography to confirm the diagnosis. But echo usually gives some clue for the vascular rings. Now coming to the respiratory distress, the alveolar problems which can cause respiratory distress. So it's always a good idea to objectively assess the severity of distress rather than saying it as simply mild distress or moderate or severe distress. It's always to have, it is good idea to objectively score the distress. There are two commonly used scores, which are Silverman-Anderson score and Down score. You all know this, most of you must be knowing. The Silverman-Anderson score, it consists of five components, that is upper chest retractions, lower chest, xiphoid, nasal flare and grunt. So five components, each is scored from 0 to 2. 0 means baby is completely normal, 2 means baby has a significant amount of respiratory distress. So in the other ones are mostly subjective. The upper chest retractions, upper chest, how do you assess, what is upper chest as far as Silverman-Anderson score is concerned? You draw an imaginary line, as a baby is lying supine in the crib, you draw an imaginary line from the axilla. The part of the chest which is above the mid-axillary line is considered as upper chest, and the part below it is lower chest. So it is considered zero if the chest as well as abdomen both move synchronously together. When both are moving synchronously, that means there is no distress. If there is some lag in inspiration, that is the chest is taking some time to keep up with the abdomen, then you call it as one. The score becomes one. If there is a seesaw kind of respiration, that is during inspiration, the chest is caving in, that is the chest is falling onto the lungs and the abdomen is moving out, and expiration is becoming opposite, then that means it is a seesaw kind of respiration, which is again severe kind of respiratory distress. This can happen in preterms. The other things are quite subjective, that is lower chest retractions, again no retraction, just visible or severe retractions, then xiphoid retractions, nasal flare similarly, and grunt. Grunt, if there is no grunt, we score it as zero. A grunt is audible only with stethoscope, we take it as one. With stethoscope is one, and if it is audible without any device, then we take it as two. That is how you score the Silverman-Anderson score. It is usually designed, it actually tells you about the severity of alveolar collapse. So it was actually designed for premature babies. So higher the score, the higher is the amount of alveolar atelectasis. That is what the Silverman-Anderson score tells you. So you can just look at the Silverman-Anderson scoring. Hope the audio video is playing. So what do you think about the upper chest? You can put it in the chat box. How much score will you give for the upper chest? Okay, so in this video, if you can see, the chest is caving in with abdomen. The abdomen is moving out and the chest is moving below. So that means there is a, what you call, the score is, it's almost like a CESA kind of respiration which is happening here. There is some xiphoid retractions and a bit of nasal flare is happening. So let us look at the another the video here. So can you all hear the grunting here? So you can see the grunt is there, but if you look in this baby, the chest and abdomen are moving in synchrony with each other. So there is no upper chest retraction, but significant grunt is there. Lower chest retraction is quite significant, and there is some xiphoid as well as some amount of flare. So this baby has a significant respiratory distress. Now, what do you want to do with this score? So is there utility for just apart from assessing? So you can decide what is the amount of respiratory support or what type of respiratory support does this baby need. If the baby has a significant amount of respiratory distress, I'm sorry, there is some hiccup. Hope you're able to see the PowerPoint. Yeah. So the if the baby has the Sillerman-Anderson score of more than 5, especially in a bigger baby who is more than 35 weeks, then that's an indication for to start with CPAP in these babies. If a baby is bigger baby, you may tolerate, that baby may tolerate a little bit of distress. So higher score, or at least 5 or more than 5, then you may take it. You may consider that this baby will need CPAP. For smaller babies, the baby is very preterm, then in such babies, then a lesser score indicates, even with a lesser score, that baby will need some kind of a respiratory support. That means this baby will need a CPAP. So with the Sillerman-Anderson score, you can decide which form of respiratory support is needed. For very preterms, especially less than 30 weeks or less than 28 weeks of babies, even little bit of respiratory distress is there. Don't just start oxygen on these babies. You always consider starting CPAP in these babies. And another score which is commonly used, especially in bigger babies, that is term babies, is Down score. This is based on respiratory rate, retraction, cyanosis, air entry, and grunting. So this also can be used, but Sillerman-Anderson score is more, tells you about the severity of the even alveolar collapse. Now, coming to the other respiratory system examination, always look for the pattern of breathing. So whether the baby is breathing in a normal way or not. Periodic breathing is quite common in neonates. It's more so in preterm babies. But this periodic breathing is nothing but there is a rapid and a shallow breathing. There is a rapid breathing for some time followed by a pause. So this pause is for usually very short. It lasts less than 10 seconds, and there is no change in vital parameters during the process of this periodic. In case of preterm babies. The other thing is apnea. So what is the difference between periodic and apnea? In apnea, the cessation of breathing is longer. It is at least for 20 seconds, or it is associated with bradycardia or cyanosis. Then we call it as apnea. The other thing in examination is AP diameter of the chest. As you can see here in this baby, there is an increased AP diameter of the chest, which tells you that there is significant amount of hyperinflation. The baby is already on some kind of a respiratory support, then probably have to come down on the pressure in these babies. So this is commonly seen in which conditions lead to this kind of hyperinflation. the baby is on not even on any kind of respiratory support. Yeah, TTN, meconium aspiration, very good. So in these babies, you can have increased AP diameter of the chest, very good. So always look for symmetry in the chest rise and also auscultate for the breath sounds, whether there is a significant amount of, how is the air entry, whether they are equally heard or not, vesicular breath sounds are equally heard or not, you should always auscultate. If a baby is on CPAP, especially bubble CPAP, always look for the bubbling sounds on both sides of the chest, whether they are symmetrically heard or not. If the baby is on a mechanical ventilator, hear the ventilator breath sounds also, whether you are able to see ventilator breath sounds symmetrically in both the sides of the chest or not. So if there is an asymmetry in breath sounds, then you can have some of the differentials I have already listed here. So if always, whenever there is asymmetry in breath sounds and is on some kind of respiratory support, then always consider the diagnosis of pneumothorax, and it can be done at the bedside. So what is shown here is a cold light. You can apply it on the chest and in a dark room. If you can make your NICU into a dark room for some time, illuminate the thorax and your diagnosis will be right, obvious right in front of you. If a baby has asymmetry in breath sounds and the baby and there's a history of polyhydramnios also and the abdomen looks like this, then the diagnosis is most likely you are properly dealing with diaphragmatic hernia. So if you have a scaphoid abdomen along with the decreased breath sounds, especially on the left side, and if possible, possibly sometimes you may also hear the gurgling sounds of the or the bubble movement sounds on the left side of the chest, then you are dealing with a case of diaphragmatic hernia. Again, this can be confirmed with a chest X-ray. Pleural effusion sometimes be asymmetric, and this can lead to a decreased air entry on one side. That is also possible. That is about something about respiratory system. Now coming to cardiovascular system. So in the on inspection, always look for again the symmetry of the chest, whether there is any asymmetry of the chest is there or not. And look for any hyperdynamic precordium, whether the apical impulse is clearly visible or the precordium is hyperdynamic. So if there's a hyperdynamic circulation, then probably, especially in preterm babies, you are dealing with a patent ductus arteriosus. In severe anemias also, you can have hyperdynamic precordium. The other thing which can happen with hyperdynamic circulations are, another example is warm shock. If baby is in warm shock, then you can have a hyperdynamic circulation that also can lead to a hyperdynamic precordium. So the other thing which you can be seen in neonates, because they have very thin chest wall, is the lift, parasternal lift. If the baby is having a significant pulmonary arterial hypertension and there is a significant right ventricular hypertrophy because of some reason, then you can feel the lift in the parasternum. Just place your hand on the parasternal area, and if there is a lift, then probably there is significant amount of RV pressure which is being felt by you. Of course, you have to auscultate for the first and second heart sounds. Not much data you will get because the tachycardia is there and the precordium is very small. So you may not be able to auscultate each and every area of the chest for the S1 and S2 sounds. But certain things are useful, especially if you are able to hear split in the second sound. That is, if you are able to clearly distinguish A2 and P2, then that is a safe thing. That means the baby is not, it tells you very important things. There is not much pulmonary hypertension because A2 and P2 are separated. So there is not much pulmonary hypertension. There are two different semilunar valves are there because two sounds are there. That means two valves are clearly there. So pulmonary valve and aortic valve are there. And presence of two ventricles is definite and it is separated by a ventricular septum. So you can come to a conclusion that there is not much pulmonary hypertension. Baby has two good ventricles and the aorta and pulmonary artery are normally positioned. So all this information can we get if you are able to hear a split. But if you don't hear a split, then that means it doesn't mean that the baby definitely has some cardiac problem. But presence of split tells you that these many things are normal in these babies. A single heart sound, single S2, especially if it's a loud and a single S2, then probably the baby's there is having a significant amount of pulmonary hypertension. So, but a neonate will have a thin chest wall. So even a normal baby can have a single loud S2, but in the presence of other conditions, other things, then that is also a clue for you to say that there is some amount of pulmonary hypertension. The other things which you have to look at it are the S3. Sometimes you may hear an S3 even in newborn. It's a sign of heart failure, that is a Gallop rhythm. So that means that the baby is having a cardiac failure. So can you name some conditions where the baby presents with cardiac failure in neonates? One or two conditions where it presents as cardiac failure. HLHS usually presents like shock rather than a cardiac failure, right? PDA is correct. PDA presents with cardiac failure. The other things are coarctation of aorta can present with cardiac failure. Truncus arteriosus can present with cardiac failure. Yeah, AV shunt, right, truncus arteriosus, that's correct. So these are some of it's very unusual for a neonate to present in a cardiac failure. Very few conditions present with CCF in neonates. The other things like hypoplastic left heart syndrome, these things they present as shock. Interruption of aortic arch, they present as shock. The other thing is fourth, S4, it's very difficult to pick up in a neonate, but it can be heard in a hypertrophic ventricle. Murmur, it's very common. Almost all of you must have heard some kind of a murmur in a neonate. But if the baby is looking otherwise healthy, then probably you are dealing with a case of innocent murmur. Are there any clues to differentiate innocent murmur from pathological? Some clues help you, especially if it is systolic murmur and it is present in the upper or lower left sternal border. The intensity is very mild, one or two. It's very short systolic murmur and rest of the neonatal examination is normal, including your pulse ox screen. If the baby is saturating more than 95% in room air, there is no pre to post septal difference. And the murmur is very short and the baby otherwise just looks healthy and is thriving well, then you are probably dealing with a case of innocent murmurs. The common reasons are the transient tricuspid regurgitation, which usually occurs in several many neonates, because as they are transitioning from a high PVR fetal circulation to a low PVR postnatal circulation, there could be a transient TR, a closing duct. Closing duct is another common reason for murmur. Another most common reason for innocent murmur is a pulmonary flow murmur. The pulmonary branches, right and left pulmonary branches, there could be some physiological turbulence in the pulmonary arteries as they are getting accustomed to the high flows once they are born. Because in the fetal life, there is hardly any pulmonary blood flow. But as the baby is born, there is a tremendous increase in your pulmonary blood flow. It takes some time for the turbulence to go out in these several neonates. And that could be the reason for murmurs in this. But if there are any, then what are the red flags? If a baby has a murmur, and what are the things where you have to investigate? So if the murmur, there is significant intensity, if there is at least more than two, that means there are three or more, then a thrill is there. There is a precordial activity, there is a parasternal lift, your pulse ox screen is abnormal, or the baby is clinically symptomatic, then in such cases, then you need to work up in these babies. That baby will need an X-ray, echocardiography, and of course ECG to finalize the diagnosis. So CVS, as sir has already told you, you should always auscultate, especially if there is unexplained CCF, then it's always a good idea to auscultate the other areas of the body, like anterior fontanelle or over the liver. And sometimes, strangely, you may hear a bruit, and this tells you that the baby is having some kind of an AV malformation. That could be the reason for this. Now, coming to the next system, that is abdominal examination. Always look for any distension of abdomen. How is the skin of the abdomen? Whether there is erythematous, edematous skin is there or not. How are the loops? Whether they are visible. And palpate for any organomegaly. Liver, spleen, kidney. Intestines may be visible. In terms, small preterm babies can have this kind of a loopy abdomen because of thin abdominal wall, or it could be a sign of intestinal obstruction. So if the baby is otherwise thriving and feeding well, there is no NG aspiration, is passing normal soon, then especially in preterms, it could be a physiological phenomenon. But if it is a baby symptomatic, that is baby is having a bilious aspirate or is not passed meconium since birth, and then it could be a case of intestinal obstruction. So always look for this kind of loopy abdomen. The other thing in the abdomen is umbilicus. So always look at the umbilicus, how the umbilicus is, whether it is healthy. when did the umbilicus fall? Try to find out the history if it is already fallen. If there was any delayed fall, it could be a sign of immune deficiency. Look for always any periumbilical erythema in duration, and if there is any abnormal discharge from the umbilicus, it could be a sign of umbilical infection. That is, omphalitis can be setting in. The other physiological things which you commonly see are umbilical hernias. Nothing need to be done about that. They usually resolve as the baby grows. And there could be an umbilical granuloma in several cases. This again resolves spontaneously in several things unless you have a significant amount of umbilical discharge. Otherwise, it usually resolves spontaneously. Or genitalia examination is again very important. The how is the male genitalia, whether the testis is well descended, how is the scrotum, whether it is well formed or not, and always look for any hydrocele or hernia. Penis, whether it is of appropriate length or not. If the length of the penis is less than 2 centimeters, we call it as micropenis. If there is a curved shaft, then we call it as chordae. So these could be the, this is important. You should always look for where is the position of the urethra. If it is there in the tip or it is abnormal. If it is below the normal position, then we call it as hypospadias. So it could be, the location can be anywhere from the in the glands to corona to shaft to the perineum. And there could be a hydrocele. But transamination will confirm your diagnosis, or it could be a chordae can be there. So always look for all these kind of abnormalities. Again, female genitalia, always whether look whether they are symmetrical or not. How are the labia? In preterm babies, you may have a prominent clitoris like this, but always don't get confused. This is a normal thing because they have a very small labia majora. They are not covering the clitoris because lack of subcutaneous fat in premature babies. If the clitoris length is, always look at the length of the, if in doubt, always measure the clitoris length. If it is less than 1 centimeter, then it is completely normal. If there is a clitoromegaly, that is more than 10 mm or 1 centimeter, then probably you are dealing with a case of ambiguous genitalia. The other thing that helps you to diagnose ambiguous genitalia is the anogenital ratio. So this anogenital ratio is nothing but it's a distance between the anus and the posterior fossae divided by the distance between the anus and the base of the phallus. This nothing but this tells you about the virilization, especially in a female baby. In a normal, in a male baby, you find the distance between this is larger, isn't it? In a female baby, the distance between the fossae and the anal opening is smaller. If this distance is large, that means if there is a fusion, the posterior fossae, there is a significant amount of fusion and there is a displacement of posterior fossae anteriorly, then probably or ventrally, then you are dealing with the case of virilization. That means this female fetus has been exposed to some kind of virilizing agent in utero, the commonest being CAH as a reason. So if you are in doubt, you can measure the what is called as anogenital ratio. It helps you in picking up the degree of virilization in a female fetus. Always note the time of passage of first voids. That is, normal babies can usually pass meconium within the first 24 hours, but premature babies can tend to pass in a delayed fashion. The higher the prematurity, there is a greater delay in passage of meconium. But usually, almost all babies will pass urine in the first 24 hours of life. Now, coming to CNS examination, this is an extensive thing. This itself will take a single class, but because of time shortage, I'll be running through. I'll not take much time for this. So, in the higher mental functions, there is level of alertness, there is behavioral state, how is the cry, how is the habituation, how is the baby consolable? Whether the baby can, there is a cuddliness in the baby, or how is the reaction? So all these things will constitute a higher mental function in a neonate. So how is the level of alertness? So this level of alertness is quite subjective in nature, and it depends on several things. So it could be what is the state, when was the last feed given, or when was the baby was sleeping or not? Is the baby on some kind of a medication which can interfere with this level of alertness, or there is some pathological abnormality? So a single examination may not be able to tell you. So it is always a good idea to look at a sequence or a period of time. How is the baby's level of alertness? Because a single point when you are examining, the baby could be simply sleeping. It may be in a deep sleep that you tend to imagine that the baby is having significant encephalopathy. But over a period of time, if you keep on examining, then you will know whether there is really a pathological issue or it is a physiological thing. So how do you define the level of alertness? When there is some problem. So level of alertness, again, you can define it by so these are the different levels of alertness. So it can be, this is based on Volpe, okay? So this is quite subjective. How is it depends upon the appearance of the baby, how is the arousal response, and how is the motor response. So motor response, again, quantitatively, how much is the motor response, and qualitatively, how is the motor response. So basing on this, Volpe classifies it as a normal alertness, stuporose, or coma. Stupor is again divided into slight, mild stupor, moderate stupor, and a deep stupor. So all these things are classified based on the degree of level of alertness. So I'm not going into detail because of time constraints. So whether the baby is drowsy or quite awake. So in a normal baby, you can define what is called as behavioral states. So there are different two types of behavioral scales which are available. So one is by Preschel, the other one is by Brazelton. Preschel defines it in five states, whereas Brazelton defines in six states. So here, this is based on the status of the eyes, whether they are open or closed, how is the respiration, how is the gross movement, and how are the vocalizations. So depending on all this, you can classify how is the baby's response. So the state one is something like a very deep sleep, that is NREM sleep, that is non-rapid eye movement sleep, that is the eyes are completely closed, no eye movements, respirations are regular, no body movements, and no vocalization. In state two, it is akin to what is called as REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep. The eyes are closed, but there is a rapid eye movement is there. The eyes are moving, respiration becomes irregular here. There may be some movement, but usually there is a significant hypotonia and there is not much movement. In state 3, the baby's eyes are open. This is called a state of quiet wakefulness. That the baby is quiet and awake. So eyes are open, respirations are regular, but there are no movements. So this is the best time to do any neurological examination and the Ballard scoring. So this is the best time where you can actively assess the entire neurological examination. In state 4, it is almost similar, but now the baby has some kind of movement. So that is why respirations become irregular now. And a crying baby is considered as state 5. So these are the different 5 states. These are the behavioral states which are normally seen in an otherwise healthy neonate. So you can also look, as you examine the baby, whether there is a change in state also, whether he is progressing from one state to other state. So if he is progressing from one state to other state, there is state to state variability, that means the baby is neurologically normal. That is another way you assess the higher mental function in a neonate. The other thing is habituation. So habituation means nothing but if you do a repeated stimulus, the baby tends to get habituated to that stimulus. It is considered as a normal cortical response. So if a baby is not getting habituated to a stimulus or is getting very early habituation, so both are considered abnormal in the case of this kind of habituation. So you can do a visual habituation or you can do an auditory habituation. Cranial nerve examination, most of the for second nerve, it is by fixation or tracking or red reflex. The 3, 4, 6, you can combine it by looking at the dorsi response. So look at the horizontal dorsi as well as vertical dorsi. A baby who is in the first 2 weeks of life, they should be having the dorsi movements, but a term neonate who is beyond 2 weeks should not. Usually they lose the dorsi movement because of the cortical response that comes with the dorsi movement. So a persistence of dorsi in a third or a fourth week neonate is considered abnormal, but in the first 2 weeks of life is considered physiological. And absence of dorsi means the baby is losing his brainstem responses. The other thing, other lower cranial nerves can be combined. If a baby is able to suck well, if he is able to swallow completely without any pooling of secretions, then almost all the lower cranial nerves are working properly. facial nerve, you can look at the symmetry of the faces, look at the nasolabial folds, look at the angles of the mouth, whether they are symmetrical or not, and the baby is crying, is there any deviation of the mouth? So all these things will tell you about the facial nerve. Similarly, as I said, the other things, 9, 10, 11, and 12, so all these things you can assess by the cranial part of accessory 11. So all these things can be assessed by simply if the baby is able to breastfeed or if the baby is able to do a proper suck, swallow, reflexes, then he's unlikely to have any other problem. Then motor system evaluation, you can look at the spontaneous movements. So how is the tone? Tone is assessed in active and a passive state, neonatal reflexes and dependent reflexes. So in the motor response, you can look at the quantity of motor response. How is the baby moving? Usually preterm babies, they have very less less movements. Slow twisting movements happen at 20 to 32 weeks, and alternating flexor movements are usually seen by 36 weeks. The in the motor response, we classify them as a good quality movement or a poor quality movement. A movement which is happening at the spinal level, that means it's a reflexive kind of a movement, is always considered as a poor quality movement. That means a spinal reflex is always repetitive in nature. It is rapid in onset, there is no latency, and it doesn't habituate. So if a movement has stereotypical, it's happening again and again, so same kind of stimulus, it is happening without any latency, and it is not habituating, then it is considered as a poor quality movement. So motor responses, look at whether there are any abnormal movements or asymmetrical movements. Look at the posture. And look at the passive tone. So in the passive tone, you can, in the upper limbs, you look at the scarf sign, arm recoil and square window. I have shown in the diagrams there. In the lower limbs, you assess by the your popliteal angles and your heel to ear. You can also look at the dorsiflexion of the ankle. These are the different norms for, it is almost like a Ballard thing only. So the same chart can be applied here for passive tone. And the next thing which you look at is the active tone. In the active tone, you look at the, but here the baby is, what kind of a response the baby is showing to your posture, to your positions, is considered as active tone. The first thing is pull to sit maneuver. So where you look at the tone of the neck flexors and extensors. So it consists of complete 180 degree movement to assess both the flexors and the extensors. And vertical suspension, here you have to suspend the baby. You are not supposed to hold the baby in the axilla. You just suspend them, and if he's slipping through, that means there is a shoulder girdle hypotonia. And in the ventral suspension, you look at the, how is the truncal tone, how is the plane, how is the head in relation to the trunk, and as well as the position of the limbs. So look at all this. If the baby is completely hypotonic, then he's going to make a U-shaped posture. Or if it is hypertonic, especially extensor hypertonia is there, then he becomes retroflexed. So these are the different neonatal reflexes. As I said, I'm not going into detail about that, the way it has to be done. This is how they are. They begin and what is the time where they are fully developed. So in a term baby, you're supposed to have a good motor reflexes with adduction. The adduction component usually happens for a babies who are more than 36 weeks of gestation. So sucking, swallowing, so all these things should be established by 32 weeks of gestation. And a coordination should be suck, swallow, respiratory coordination happens by 34 weeks of gestation. Deep tendon reflexes are very difficult to elicit in neonates. Knee jerk you may elicit, but upper limb reflexes, biceps, triceps, you may get it, but it's very difficult. The ankle clonus, there's one point I'd like to tell you. The clonus is physiological in neonates. But if there's a persistent clonus, a significant persistent clonus, then it is considered as abnormal. The plantar reflexes has got no value in a neonate. It can be flexor or extensor, even in normal newborn. So it does not have any cortical, there is no localizing sign for the plantar reflexes. So you do not do the plantar reflex in neonates. Then in neurological examination, always look at the skull. Shape of the skull, look for any plagiocephaly or any craniosynostosis. How was the AF anterofrontal, whether it's a bulging anterofrontal is there, how are the sutures, whether they are wide open, whether they are shrunken. So all these things you have to look at in the skull examination. And spine also, it's very mandatory that turn the baby to the back and then look for the spine, look for any signs of spina bifida or any other problems that are there in the this one. The common thing which happens is presacral dimple. I've put it here because many people get confused between the spina bifida occulta and presacral dimple. This presacral dimple is very close to the anus. And it may have a little bit of hair, and it is usually a blind pouch, and it has to be very close to the anus. So it is innocuous. It does not need any anus one. But the same thing is there beyond 2.5 centimeters from the anus, then you are properly dealing with a spina bifida occulta. The other thing which you should examine in is the hip examination, especially at discharge. You are supposed to examine for the instability of the hip. For that, you need to do Ottolani and Barlow's test. So in this in the Barlow's test, you're trying to dislocate the hip. So you do a medial adduction with a posterior pressure so that you're trying to dislocate the hip. And if it is getting dislocated by Ottolani's test, you're trying to relocate the hip. That is, you're now doing abduction there. So both these tests will help you whether there is a significant hip instability is there or not. If there is, then the baby will need a ultrasound examination. But usually these are transient and this tends to get settled within the first 1 month of age. But if it is persistent beyond 1 month, then these babies will need intervention for developmental dysplasia of hip. So a few things about an otherwise healthy baby, but he needs some focused examination. So what is this? What is this baby having? He's having a bilateral CTEV. So in any case of bilateral CTEV, which thing we have to examine? Yes, it is bilateral CTEV. So you should always look at the spine. Whenever you have a bilateral CTEV, always look at the spine because there could be a case of spina bifida occulta can be there in these babies. So you always look for the spine to examine the spina bifida. So what is this? Is there anything in the face you can see? So this is a port vein stain. Yes, right. I think some of you answered. So this is a port vein stain which is occurring in the ophthalmic region. So especially when it is there in the ophthalmic distribution of the trigeminal nerve, you should always suspect a case of Sturge Weber. So this baby will need a neurological examination, a proper neurological examination and a MRI of the brain to look for the Sturge Weber syndrome. If it is happening in the mandibular or in the V2 area, then it is unlikely to be associated with this. But if it is extensive, if it is there in the entire all three regions of trigeminal distribution, again, it's a risk factor for Sturge Weber. Yes, so what is this? How is the limb posture? So this is a case of, you can see, it's a Erb's palsy. The baby is having the limb in a rotated position, the old policeman tip kind of a thing. Okay, so you should always look for traumatic delivery. Take a history whether there is any history of obstructed labor or there is a traumatic delivery. Always look for any fracture of the clavicle. Look for humeral fractures or clavicle fractures. So what is this? This baby is having a big kephale spot. So multiple kephale spot. It could be a feature for neurofibromatosis. I think I have come to the end of this lecture. Hello.
So we will open to the organizers to take over so that they can. Sir, Dr. C. N. Reddy, sir, and.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes. Okay. Yes, sir.
Can you hear me? Thank you very much, Dr. Srinivas and Dr. Sriram. Very nice lecture and very much useful to practicing pediatricians and PGs. And thank you very much for giving an excellent lecture. I will hand over to Dr. Bhaskar.
Hello, am I audible?
You're audible, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivas and Dr. Sriram, for your excellent talk, as expected, about the basics of this structural examination of newborn. I am sure all the participants had must have benefited a lot from your talk, and these basics are really very important to make our foundation very strong, which can lead to the better understanding of the ailments. I sincerely thank these both the speakers, and I thank all the participants for actively participating in this webinar. And tomorrow, same time, 8 o'clock, we have genetics in children, genetic evaluation in children, that is genetics in pediatrics, by Dr. Gayatri. She's a senior geneticist from Fernandez Hospital. Thank you. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.